Of course, we have seen investor sentiment being hit with these latest headlines on virus resurgence, but still, we have seen this continuing trend of the disconnect between the financial markets and the real economy. What do you make of the rebound that we have seen in the second quarter?
Absolutely. Well, firstly, Shery, thank you very much for having me this morning. Look, I think it's fair to say the markets globally at the moment are being driven almost entirely by the pandemic and the response to it. So whether it's the growth in cases, whether it's any news of any kind of medical advancement, you see significant moves in the market responding to those sorts of trends. As you said, I think that, I should also say that in addition, we've seen unprecedented policy response all around the world and across many parts of Asia. And so I think that's all helped push markets. I do think that in the last few days, we have seen not only the large number of cases in the US that you spoke to earlier, but also in a number of markets in Asia, places where people had confidence the pandemic was more under control, be it Beijing, be it South Korea, or even the state of Victoria in Australia, all countries that were seen as having a fairly firm hand on the pandemic. The fact that there's been a relatively small but an uptick in cases nevertheless, I think it's not unreasonable to expect that will make investors nervous. But I think we can say that markets are being completely driven by these trends, whether it's case numbers, medical responses, and also the policy response we've seen, which really has been unprecedented.
On the policy response, we have seen, of course, these massive liquidity in the financial system from central bank support globally. How does BlackRock adjust their fund strategies to this new normal?
Well, I think one of the things we're very focused on with clients, actually, is that once again, and it seems this has been an overture of the last few years, we're looking at lower rates for a longer period of time. And I think even lower and even longer than perhaps any of us might have anticipated. And one of the things we're certainly talking to many of our clients about is their concern about their ability to meet their liabilities over time in an environment where yields are so low. So whether it's insurance companies, pension funds, these are organizations with real liabilities that need to be met, and a real risk for them is that they're unable to do so unless they take, you know, potentially more risk in the portfolio. We want to work with them to appropriately manage that.
With central banks taking such a big role in bond markets, for example, bond curbs, break-even rates, really offering less information about the health of the economy, how do you go about really assessing where the global economy is at now?
Well, I think we're seeing, it's fair to say, a fairly unprecedented contraction. I think there's been a lot of optimism in markets as some markets have moved to reopening and looking for any indication of, you know, all sorts of statistics about demand, particularly both the ability of economies to restart supply, but then very importantly, what kind of demand we're seeing. Obviously, that varies very broadly by sector. And so, it's difficult to make generalizations. We need to look sector by sector, geography by geography. But I think the markets have been hopeful about restarting. And as I said earlier, unfortunately, some of the case increases we've seen around the region in the last few days may actually undercut that in the markets in the next few days or weeks.
Geraldine, let's zoom in on one of those geographical sectors then. Let's take a look at EM Asia funds. In some cases, they've recovered their losses. Even though this crisis, as you point out, is far from over, economies are still suffering. So how concerned are you that things may have overshot a little bit?
Look, I think we're cautiously optimistic. We do recognise that emerging markets around the world, I would actually say less so in Asia at this point, but emerging markets around the world, it is absolutely anticipated that they will take a disproportionate hit. I think one of the outcomes of this COVID pandemic is actually going to be that we're going to see greater inequality in the world, both within countries and across countries. Many emerging market economies are very dependent on trade and tourism, etc. That is obviously going to be impacted, and there's concerns about the healthcare response in some of those countries, their ability to respond to very large numbers of cases. Having said that, in Asia, we do have counterexamples. Countries like Vietnam have been seen to do very well. So again, I think it's difficult to generalise, and we need to be quite nuanced and quite focused in our analysis. But emerging markets is certainly something we'll be watching globally. The sort of talk of defaults, et cetera, has obviously been in non-Asian markets at this point, but we will continue to watch very closely.
Yeah, as we see earnings come under pressure, debt is growing as well, leveraging is getting ever higher. How do you perceive the default risk at the moment?
I mean, obviously, as I said, varies across sectors, et cetera. I think that what we are also seeing, though, is extraordinary response from governments to support various industries. And so I think that we need to let some of that play through. I think it's interesting we're now seeing from various governments talks of either renewal or extension of a variety of programs. But there are there is obviously a heightened default risk just given the economic contraction in the world. But we do see pretty extraordinary policy response targeted in some sectors to try and reduce the possibility of that, protect employment, et cetera. So I don't think it's just as simple as economic contraction, default risk higher. We are, you know, we do think there are pockets of high quality credit and we're looking to direct our investors towards them.
So when you say it depends on the sectors, what sectors do you see the most risks, whether it's globally or in the Asia Pacific?
Look, I think it's obvious ones that have come under pressure, you know, whether it's retail, travel, et cetera. Those things are obviously under enormous pressure. I do think, though, that we are just seeing multiple countries across Asia Pacific, which obviously are now expected to go into recession. And so I think anything that's, you know, dependent on consumer spending, I think we're obviously going to see some tightening. I think it's going to be reasonably broad-based, although, as I said, some sectors like the travel industry have received strong government support, and it's going to be a wait and see, depending on, back to my original point, the path of the pandemic and the possibility of some of those sectors restarting in a meaningful way.
Are those some of the sectors where BlackRock also sees some opportunities?
As I said, there are pockets of quality credit out there that we are looking to, but I don't think it's a uniform thing, and so we need to be more targeted in that.
Let's turn to China, because we have seen efforts to carry on financial reform, but of course, do you expect this to continue post-pandemic?
Sorry, what was that, Shery? Do I expect what to continue?
China financial reform.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, that is our expectation. Throughout the challenges that have existed in China over the last couple of years, we've seen not only a continuation, but actually an acceleration of financial reform in the Chinese markets. And we think that will continue. In addition to, obviously, the challenges created by the pandemic, I think that there are a number of other issues. For example, a real challenge around retirement in the Chinese economy, something that BlackRock is very focused on, helping people protect their long-term financial futures. And I think there's a recognition amongst Chinese policymakers that in order to help Chinese people save for retirement and invest for retirement more meaningfully over time, that deeper capital markets, a long-term investing culture, more pension infrastructure, et cetera, would be beneficial. And we think that they're very committed to developing those things.
Yes, well, we got a timely reminder just yesterday when Peter Navarro made comments that appeared to put the US trade relationship on the skids, which were hastily rewound by President Trump. But more broadly, are you concerned about the risk of a US-China decoupling?
Look, I mean, obviously, yes. Geopolitics has become a far more significant force in global markets and global investing than it was a few years ago, and the US-China challenges are at the centre of that. We are hopeful that I understand the White House came out to clarify the phase one of the trade deal will continue. We're hopeful that global trade will continue to grow. Obviously, with the world being under significant financial hardship, we believe that global trade is important to restoring economic growth around the world. But there's no doubt that geopolitics has become a more meaningful force in markets. And one that we, as other investors will have to understand and navigate more than perhaps we did historically.
Yeah, against the backdrop of this US-China tension, does this have any implications for BlackRock or for other firms that are looking to build their operations in China?
At this stage, I would say no. We're optimistic. We are committed to long-term plans in China, both in terms of building the market, but also as a fiduciary where we see investment opportunities for our global clients to invest, we will work to enable that. But it has certainly made things a little bit more complicated than they were previously, but our focus and commitment to China remains.
What can you tell us about a potential subsidiary wealth management service with China Construction Bank?
Yeah, so BlackRock's been fairly public about our interest in building an onshore business, that is developing onshore investment capabilities for onshore investors, as well as over time making those onshore investment opportunities available to global investors. So we're pursuing a number of opportunities, including partnerships with domestic institutions to try and progress the Black business onshore.
Would that include CCB?
It has been publicly reported in the past that we're talking to CCB, yes.
What sort of regulatory framework would that fall under? What sort of product categories can you actually sell? Can you give us a little bit more details of what that would entail?
Yeah, I mean, the project that we're working with them will be primarily directed towards the more retail investor base in China, which is very significant and growing quite quickly. It's fair to say that the investment market in China has not been historically as sophisticated as other parts of the world. Investors tend to invest very heavily in money fund-like products, and there has been significant speculation in the equity markets. So we'd be looking to try and, through the use of multi-asset product, et cetera, ETFs over time, potentially try and help build a longer-term investment culture, bring our client focus and fiduciary principles to China, as we do everywhere, to try and help people save for their long-term financial future in a way that we think is risk appropriate and ultimately helps them reach their goals.
Geraldine, just quickly, whether it's globally here in the U.S. with Robinhood or it's a Chinese Asian retail investors locked up at home trading, what do you make of this sort of retail investing going actively managing their finances? What does that do to a passive fund manager like BlackRock?
Well, firstly, BlackRock's not just a passive fund manager. BlackRock manages a very wide range of products, including passive products, but right through the active spectrum and includes illiquid alternatives. I think that we certainly see around the world retail investors wanting to participate in the management of their portfolios. I think it's relatively small compared to the overall retail market, where the vast majority of money is either managed through advisors or intermediaries or pension funds on behalf of individuals. So I think there's a role to play for that. Our goal is that people be well educated in financial risk, they understand the risk they're taking, and that they ultimately, we help enable them make good decisions for their long-term financial future.